Stretching by itself can be a time-bound exercise. You go at a particular time and you come back home at a particular time. And this is something that is very much encouraged by the family and the society. So, and in the case of male teachers, they are not encouraged really to, look at the watch, look at the time. When they take on projects, when they do research, when they move out and do many assignments, that is what is encouraged for them. But for women, it is thought ki हाँ आपको जाना है, पढ़ाना है और घर वापस आना है, because गृहस्थी है.
हेलो फ्रेंड्स, आई अनुपम मिश्रा वेलकम यू टू द 10th एपिसोड ऑफ कॉम्सपायर, कम्युनिकेट टू इंस्पायर. आई होप दैट यू हैव बीन लविंग दिस सीरीज ऑफ कॉम्सपायर. एंड टुडे आई हैव कम अप विद सम स्पेशल ऑन वुमेन्स डे ईव. एंड वी हैव एज अ गेस्ट डॉक्टर नसरीन, हु इज़ अ प्रोफेसर इन टाटा इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ सोशल साइंसेज एट प्रेजेंट. हेलो मैम. Hello Nasreen ma'am,
Hi,
thank
good
you so
evening.
much. Thank you so much for accepting this invitation, and I am really proud to get such an identity in front of me who has worked for more than 30 years for the welfare of the society. Ma'am, you are associated with Tata Institute of Social Sciences as a professor and have been working as a professor for more than 3 decades in higher education institutions. How do you feel about yourself being a part of education for such renowned associations?
Good evening, Anupam, and thank you for inviting me to be a part of your podcast. I really feel very honored. And as far as your first question is concerned, I would say that I have great pride in being associated with the Tata Institute of Social Sciences. And especially because I have been there for such a long time, I feel that I am a part of its history, from 1985 when I joined there till the time I superannuated in February 2020. This institution and the values that it holds itself to is something that it has been inseparable from me actually. The very fact that it has always dedicated itself to working with the poor, with the marginalized. My whole intention of doing the post-graduation from TISS was actually to work with people in marginalized communities. And as soon as I graduated in 1977 itself, I started working with slum communities in the city of Bombay. I worked with an NGO for 7 years and then I joined the institute. Working with adults, working with adult learners was something that, it had already appealed to me in the first 7 years of my career. And the fact that I was able to pursue that at TISS and that TISS encouraged me, supported me in every way to offer courses which were not marketable at all. They were not paying the institute anything. In fact, there was a lot of investment from our side and there was nothing like returns. It was difficult to mobilize students for such courses. We needed to convince people that they had to work in occupations such as social work, such as working with seniors, such as, women empowerment. None of these things were very easy at a time when we began such courses. And the institute consistently supported me to do that and supported my center to do that. Nothing could have been more rewarding.
Listening to you, I feel more inquisitive, like when you are telling that when we are dealing with such sort of institution, which is working for slum dwellers or underprivileged people, we are not going to get anything in return. Yes, of course, people like when they are going to work or they are going to learn something, they always think of getting something in return. So that was a great job you might have really done, convincing the people to come for such sort of courses. But again, I want to know, how did you really convince, like what is the motive that is required to let the people enter into such sort of courses?
I think the main thing that individuals have in them when they want to pursue courses like this is, their desire to actually be of use to society. I have consistently seen people who have left careers in management, in marketing, in banking, and they have come to learn, you know, a subject like counseling. They have come to learn how to work with senior citizens. They have come to learn how to work with youth, marginalized youth. And they have all left what could otherwise have been considered as, you know, careers which would have probably paid them much more. And in all the interviews that we did with such learners who actually left such, you know, sectors and came into social work and social development work, I could see that there was just a burning desire for them to change. They just wanted to change. And very often we would hear such people saying, ab bahut ho gaya, humne wo bahut kar liya. You know, we've done enough of that. I think I want to do something else. And the second reason that motivated such people was actually their own life experience. Many of these people came because they had senior people at home. They had loved ones who had, you know, whom they had lost because of cancer or some other really, you know, serious illness. Also very stressful situations through which they had passed, or they had seen their family passing. They had lost people whom they loved. And these were also the reasons for why they wanted to sort of leave what could be considered as paying careers and come into work like this.
There is one more thing I would like to add over there. I know that you are so experienced and have seen so many people. But yes, of course, whatever earning we have, whatever profession we are in, that doesn't give that sort of gratification. What we get when we really help others, when we are in some sort of social services. And yes, of course, the kind of satisfaction at the end you might be getting, like, I did something today.
I think you may be right there. There are very few nights when I've actually lost sleep because of something wrong that I might have done.
Yeah.
I have been very lucky in life to be able to pursue a career where I didn't have to do anything wrong.
Yeah.
I didn't have to bribe people. I have never had to tell lies.
Yeah.
I have never had to kuch bada chada ke kuch batana hai.
Right.
Kisi ko kuch market karna hai. Aisa mujhe kabhi zindagi mein nahi karna.
Ma'am, you have been involved in curricular building, designing and delivering capacity building programs for the development sector, including women leadership in higher education. Can you please discuss about your role in building the confidence and other skills of women?
Of course, you know, building curriculum and designing and delivering is the normal part of any of the life of any academic person.
Yeah.
I have learned a lot actually when, you know, devising programs for different groups. I have myself been a lifelong learner, which, by the way, is also the name of my center, the Center for Lifelong Learning, we call it. And when I began this particular program, working along with our ex-director of the institute, Dr. Armaiti Desai, she later, after completing her stint with the Tata Institute, she went on to become the chairperson of the UGC. So when she introduced us, a group of us, to this particular program, she was the chairperson at the UGC. And this was her brainchild. Her enthusiasm and passion was something that really inspired me to give my best to this particular program. In this particular program, we were working with mid-level women faculty in universities to encourage them to aspire to leadership positions. Because we found that there were a lot of women who joined at the base level. So as lecturers, as assistant professors, 80 to 90% of the workforce in an institution would possibly be women. But as you move upwards, you see that most of the senior positions, you know, the heads, the controller of examinations, and of course, definitely the vice chancellors, all these positions were all occupied by men. So what is it that happened to these women who joined, you know, at the base level? And why didn't they get to the leadership positions? And we found that there were two or three definite issues that we needed to look at. The issues, there were some which were external, they were out there in the environment, and there were some issues which were actually also internal. So the internal issues were really to do with the struggle that women face between their personal and their professional commitments. Teaching by itself can be a time-bound exercise. You go at a particular time and you come back home at a particular time. And this is something that is very much encouraged by the family and the society. So, and in the case of male teachers, they are not encouraged really to, look at the watch, look at the time. When they take on projects, when they do research, when they move out and do many assignments, that is what is encouraged for them. But for women, it is thought कि हाँ आपको जाना है, पढ़ाना है और घर वापस आना है, because गृहस्थी है. तो in that situation, after coming to a certain level, women had this real tussle in their mind, and it was very difficult for women without the full support of their family to continue to move upwards. So in this tussle, generally the career lost out, the profession lost out, and it was generally the family and the societal expectations that won. So we worked with women in this program to encourage them to balance the two. We didn't say that give up one for the other. It need not be. I think that is another thing that we really need to understand, that balancing doesn't mean that we have to give up one for the other. But if there is one which is so dominant, then something from that dominant part will have to be given away. This is how we put it. So what is balance? Balance ultimately is your ability to see if you are giving reasonably well to both sides or to all sides or to many sides. Because, in the personal, there is also elder care. There is child care. There is not only home care. And all of these are very time-consuming tasks for women to do.
Yes, ma'am. So it is your well-researched thing that you stated that for balancing, we need not leave, like, that doesn't mean that we have to leave one thing and go for the other. So that's a great
Yes.
point, because for women, it has always been a problem that if you are choosing a career, leave your family. And if you are going
Yes.
with your family, leave your career. And so now you
Yes.
have nicely elaborated it that it is not required. You can go along with both of them. And
That's right.
that will really help the lady to get into leadership. I remember many of the people in the organization, they say that women cannot be the leader because they have different other responsibilities that they have to
Yes.
bear. So yes, of course, men too need to understand. They also put this kind of barrier, and ladies also accept that barrier that I cannot. So both of them have to understand, and then they can move ahead.
Yeah.
Ma'am, you yourself being a woman, and from the point where you have started, yes, of course, you might have struggled a lot, and then you have reached to the position where you are right now. When we are talking about leadership, when we are talking about leading at some organization, that really means that you have traveled a long way to reach over there. So, ma'am, I would request you to talk about any of the obstacles in your life which looked very tough in the beginning, but you managed to handle that with your inner strength.
I don't really know about inner strength, Anupam, because I think that that's a term which I began to understand much later in life. At the time when I just wanted to do something and it didn't always work out, I only thought that I had to just keep going at it. And I didn't give it any name. I don't think I was aware enough. I didn't have so many lessons from life, and I think I had my parents before me, both of them in their own way, just determined to do something. And I don't remember them giving me any lectures. There was no moralizing from them on hard work and commitment. They just did it, and obviously I was watching, what they did, and I think that's where it got absorbed. So I know that my mother used to work for a small charity. And I grew up in the city of Hyderabad, Telangana. And when I was growing up in the 1960s and early 70s, Hyderabad was a fairly small and a conservative place. And my mother used to step out to collect donations for a charity. I just saw her. So whether she collected a 500 rupees, a small amount, or, you know, whether she collected what in those days was a larger amount, like 5,000 rupees. But I just saw her determinedly doing, amongst other things.
Yeah, that's the inner strength you're talking about. You said that you didn't know about that inner strength at that time. But that is the inner strength, that determination, that you have to just move on, keep on moving.
And both my parents, you know, my mother was a school dropout and my father dropped out after the 12th standard.
Okay. And still they were able to manage such thing and they were able to build you at that age. Just imagine you were educated at that time, that point where women education was not so important. And even in Telangana, if you're talking about. So that itself is a kind of surprise. Like they were not educated, but they made you to get this degree, which is the highest degree in our nation.
That's correct.
Ma'am, when we are talking about like the kind of leadership campaign you are going for or the way you are dealing with the other students of yours. So if anyone who wants to be like you or wants to pursue a career like you, what are the requirements for that?
I don't know whether I would say that there are any requirements. But I would say that if you really wish to pursue a career, I think what is important is to sort of be prepared to give it your full sort of effort and to be able to see a purpose in what you are doing. Yes. Because, you know, money by itself, just earning by itself, maybe right in the beginning or just at the start, it might suffice as a reason, you know. But ultimately, in what you are doing, for it to become a career, for it to become a profession, you need to see that there is a purpose. That you are doing something which is fulfilling your own inner aptitude, your own nature. You know, what you want out of something, you are getting it.
Yeah.
And if that is there, then I think that one is able to build a career in whatever, you know, it could be... It could be drama, it could be the arts, it could be in anything actually. You'll be able to build a career.
Yeah, so basic requirement that you just need to know that why you are doing that thing. So when you know the purpose, yes, of course, you can do anything in your life. And that's a great lesson for all the listeners. I hope that the people are listening to you and they're able to get this point. Any scale, any part of the profession you want to excel in, you want to get into, you just need to know why you are doing that and what do you want. So the purpose, the motive of it. Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. Nasreen, ma'am, you have pursued your PhD in social work, focusing in non-profit management from TISS, that is Tata Institute of Social Sciences. Can you please tell us in brief about your research that you have taken over there?
Actually, management of nonprofit organizations is a relatively recent area of study. So I'm saying relatively recent. It's not like it's 5 or 10 years old.
Mm-hmm.
The great management guru, Peter Drucker, has also, in fact, written a book on nonprofit management. And he said in his book that, in fact, corporate management has a lot to learn from the nonprofits. And he himself was on the boards of several, you know, church organizations.
Yes, ma'am.
So faith-based organizations and other bodies. From there, he picked up several lessons, including the lessons of, you know, commitment.
Okay.
And one of his very well-known principles, which said, keep to the knitting, he said. Yani ki, jo aapki khasiyat hai, you know, what you do best. Mm-hmm. Organizations should, you know, do that. Mm-hmm. So he wasn't at that time so much into this whole business of what we talk today in terms of, say, multitasking or doing varied things. He said, you need to excel at something that you are doing. And he said, that is a lesson that we can learn from the nonprofits.
Yeah.
So this whole business of nonprofit management is that as an organization or as leaders in an organization or as managers of an organization where there is no economic benefit. So it doesn't mean that you make a loss or that you are always going around with a begging bowl. It's not like that.
Okay.
But the point is that making money is not what you are
looking for.
Is your ultimate goal.
Yeah.
So the ultimate goal in a non-profit is to be able to deliver a service efficiently and effectively. So in that sense, I did my research with the hospitals. The specific area of work was job satisfaction of nursing personnel. So what is it that gives job satisfaction in an organization like a hospital to an employee such as the nurse? And I had a comparison between a public hospital and a private hospital.
So you are talking in the perspective of hospitals, but we know very well that there are many jobs. Even if you talk about school teachers, like I have been teaching for more than 15 years by now, and there we know very well that 50% or even I can say more than that, teachers are not there just to teach. They are there just to earn from teaching. And when they are only just because of some responsibilities, just because of some burden that they have, then yes, of course, that job satisfaction is not there. And when that job satisfaction is not there, they are not able to give their best. And who is at loss? No one else but our whole nation, because the
Yeah,
nation
absolutely.
depends on the teachers.
Absolutely. There is also some amount of study on millennials, you know, the young people that we have today, that for them, the driver of what will keep them in employment is more satisfaction rather than money.
Yes, ma'am.
So I don't have much information on this, but there are some studies which point to the fact that young people also look for satisfaction along with money.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, in this process of whatever you have been doing, whatever service you are giving to our society, what is your special quality of yours which motivates you to do such sort of things again and again?
I think wanting to reach out to somebody when I hear that something needs to be done for and with somebody, I think my mind starts working on what are some things that can be done actually. So it's I think it's just an aptitude in the sense of wanting to reach out, wanting to do something that can be done in whatever be it might be difficult circumstances or whatever. But what is it that I can do really motivates me to stay in this work. And I don't really know what could be the source of that for me in my life. But there is an incident, when I was finishing my graduation, that gave me an insight that this was something that I was very comfortable with. And that was when I was finishing my graduation and my subject was history. I did very well. And all my teachers in college were very happy with whatever marks I was getting in the subject. And I was doing well. So, towards the end of the course, one of my teachers asked me, she was our teacher for ancient Indian history. She asked me if I would come to Baroda and pursue my post-graduation. And she said she would be my guide. And at that time, I had already started thinking of going into a course like social work. And I had already done some amount of exploring on Tata Institute and what the course was and all of that. So I told her that I was going to do social work. And she was actually nonplussed. She kept quiet for about 30 seconds and then she said, "But Nasreen, do you know that in social work you have to talk to people?" So I was rather quiet. I was a reserved person, and she obviously she had observed me. So I said, "Yes, ma'am, I will talk to people."
I'm ready
And
to
it
talk
was
to
just that simple. I was 19. I was 19 years old, but that's all. And then she asked me a second time. She said, "Are you sure? Have you given it a thought? Would you like to come to the Baroda University? I'm going to be there. I'm leaving Bombay also." And I told her, "No, I have made up my mind to go to that institute." So I don't know. It was just something in terms of that I felt I should
Yes,
do
ma'am.
it.
So at that point, you again, when you talked about determination and that thing that you can go it, so you realized your potential. Then you can of course talk with people and go ahead where that is required, being
Yeah,
quiet
maybe
child
move
as well.
out of the comfort zone. Yeah, and maybe when one is young, one still thinks one can do it. कि अभी मैं नहीं कर रही हूँ पर कर सकती हूँ.
Ma'am, in your life, like there might be so many people that you have come through, but who was the most influential to you with which you could connect yourself?
So when you say that, three women and two men.
Okay.
So amongst the first people to influence me was my school principal, and she started the school, and I was in the first batch of that school. Along with eight other people. So we were a very small batch because, the school began with us. We were the first batch to pass out of the school. She was one person who just told me that I need to ask more questions, that I need to talk more. Yeah. So she mustn't have known that later on I'll talk so much that people will have to ask me to keep quiet. But yes, I came from a traditional conventional family. As a child also, obedience was a value at home, which was much value. So obedience, agreeing with the adults, accepting what they say, these were all qualities which were valued in our family as I grew up. So asking questions was some kind of a very different
You
topic for me.
cannot ask like army personnel, so disciplined.
And my school principal told me that I should ask questions. And
I
I could
see.
see her, the way in which she behaved and, the way in which she would put forward her point of view.
So she became an idol at that point of
Yeah,
view.
very much. Yeah. She was very much an idol for me at the age of, what's it, 14, 13, 14, 15. Yeah. The second one is a lady I met in the course of my democratic rights work. She could have lived a very, very easy, comfortable life. An extremely intelligent person who also studied at the London School of Economics. But she came back to India to, to be a journalist and to be working with the marginalized. When I met her, I had already completed my course at TISS. At TISS, I understood some of the skills, the techniques, gave me the knowledge, really, marginalized and vulnerable groups. Gave me an understanding of caste, class, gender, all the concepts that we really need to understand the differences that are in society, and that despite these differences, one needs to work for our constitutional values, like we say, equality, justice, all of this. But what I learned from her was the attitude to that work. So I got my skills, I got my knowledge, I got my information from TISS. But the very strong perspective that she gave me of being partial to the marginalized, of not tolerating injustice, which, by the way, was a seed which was also planted by my principal. I think for both these people, the whole idea of unfairness and that, one should not tolerate what is unfair, one should not tolerate what is unequal. I think it really became a part of my DNA, I would say. And, so not the genetic DNA, but the learning DNA.
Yes, ma'am.
And these two things, these two ladies, stayed with me very strong. Third lady was somebody I met much later. And she inspired me actually to be a good academic. And what it means to really work hard. The two gentlemen, I would say, under one of them, I learned the ideas of what he taught as unconditional love and forgiveness. An American. It opened the doors for me to understand an issue which was not in that sense practical. I had, from whatever experiences that I had till that time, they were extremely down to earth, practical, to do with issues of people's struggles, working with the poor, what can be the best ways of sort of solving issues, issues of inequality, issues of patriarchy, you know, domination by certain groups in society. All this was really very hardcore basic stuff. And what I learned from Charles is really something in terms of self-growth. Not just growth in career, not just growth in a perspective, but something to do with growth in... And those were some years when I was going through several personal difficulties.
Yes, ma'am.
And during that period, what I understood, you know, in working with a person like Charles, his humility, his approachability.
Okay.
And yeah, and I don't know from where that the personality that he had, just of radiating warmth. Yeah. So, I mean, after all, he was not a light that, you know, you could get warmth or heat out of him. But he was a light in thinking. His thinking was not cerebral. His thinking was something that gave warmth. And that is something that stayed with me.
And right now, ma'am, what I feel that you are one of the like most empowerful and enlightening lady that I have met. Because the way you are talking about your experiences, the way you are talking about your research, and apart from that, showing your gratitude to everyone with which you could learn something, with which you could move ahead. So that's really a kind of great personality of yours, which is reflected over here, ma'am.
Nothing like that.
Ma'am, this is a kind of special episode on the eve of Women's Day. So I would request you to highlight the three major problems of women in India. We know that, yes, of course, there are so many related problems to one thing to the other. But according to you, what is the major prominent problems of women in India? Any three problems that you think?
I think one of the most critical problems for women in India is their socialization. The way in which their family treats them and grooms them, I think, is a very major problem. The way in which girls are brought up, if they have to develop their own agency later in life, they have to really struggle against the way in which they are brought up.
Pre-made rules.
And I don't know, this is the part that I still feel quite dissatisfied with. That I don't think there is much difference in my upbringing and the upbringing that girl child is getting today in this country.
Yeah, you're right.
And my upbringing was in the 1960s, I'm saying.
Yeah.
If you compare 1960s se leke 2020 tak,
jyada changes nahi hai.
Hamara jo haan, hamara jo palan poshan hai, jo humko bada karne ki jo practices hai, agar wo nahi badli hai, अगर उनके मूल्य नहीं बदले हैं, उनके तरीके नहीं बदले हैं, तो I think that really
needs certain attention.
Yeah, that's why I think that, you know, women achievers, whatever they have achieved,
it's because of lot of struggles that they
lot
have.
Of struggle, lot of struggle,
right.
Lot of struggle. Each woman is an example, I think, in herself for you know what she has to unlearn. And what she has to try and do to come to a certain stage in her career, in her work, in the way she can interact with other people in society. I think it's an immense. It's not that we haven't moved ahead.
Yeah.
Indian women have moved ahead. But I think this problem of socialization is really very
clear. Yeah, that system has not changed. Yes, the women are perspiring. Women are really struggling, moving ahead. But the system is same. The upbringing is same.
And the values associated with that upbringing.
Yeah. Ma'am, you have been an inspiration for so many people by now. And through your whatever you have learned, that you don't keep it with yourself. You're sharing it with everyone. And right now you are associated with, or you have been associated with, adult learning, training and facilitation programs. I would request you to tell our audience what type of that kind of facilitation you do and how you are able to train those adult people that they should really go for this adult learning program and there is no age barrier for them to learn anything.
Yeah, that's what you said is correct. There is no age barrier. Any stage, any age in life, one can continue to learn. So actually in 2006, we renamed our center as the Center for Lifelong Learning.
Yeah.
And it was that's when the institute got restructured and, we reconstituted our departments and research units we used to have at the time. And we renamed them. In the process, we got this opportunity to rename our center. Before that, we used to be called the Department of Extramural Studies. And when I used to introduce the department and say Department of Extramural Studies, everyone was very polite. And, they would say, lovely name. And then next thing they would ask is, what does it mean? So, it was obvious. It was a very nice name, no doubt. But it wasn't sufficiently giving the message. What does it really mean?
Mm-hmm.
So when we had the opportunity, we said, isko seedha aur simple, sulabh, Center for Lifelong Learning bata do, sabko samajh mein aa jayega ki ye kya. So the Center for Lifelong Learning has been offering certificate and diploma programs and postgraduate diploma programs for adult learners. And we started very early. And one of the people who really inspired me is my earlier head of department, Dr. Geeta Shah.
Mm-hmm.
Very lovely, gracious person,
mm-hmm.
Very large heart, and a very wonderful large laugh. So, yeah. So the moment she laughed, you had to laugh along with her. She was very cheerful, very outgoing person.
Yes, ma'am.
And along with her, we started a certificate in social work because from our experience, we understood that there were many people who are in the NGO, the social sector field,
mm-hmm.
who had not done any formal training in social work.
Yes, ma'am.
Apart from this course, we then started increasing our number of courses and we started offering a course, a diploma in counseling. We offered a certificate and a diploma in gerontology.
Mm-hmm.
That's working with seniors.
Mm-hmm.
And then we moved to a certificate course in youth leadership and social change. So counseling, elderly, youth. And we were also offering customized programs. Many organizations approached us for short programs of 5 days, 10 mm-hmm. days. What in a business school they refer to as management development programs.
Mm-hmm.
But for us, it is not management. It is mm-hmm. the whole social sector, the development field that we are looking at. So these programs we began to offer. And we followed some very basic principles of what we know as andragogy.
Okay.
Andragogy is the science of learning with adults. And it's different from pedagogy in the sense that peda, PEDA, like
yes,
pediatric,
ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Means children, And
I learned that in B.Ed. Actually, I have done my B.Ed.
So oh, wonderful. Then you are I don't need to say more. So the basic principle of andragogy is that people don't come to you as a blank slate. Adults
yes,
have their own life experience.
Yes, ma'am.
And when you are doing any work in learning with adults,
mm-hmm.
you need to involve them. You need mm-hmm. to engage them by recognizing their previous experience.
Yes, ma'am.
By validating the previous experience, by acknowledging it.
Yes,
and
ma'am.
Not to treat them like they are empty vessels and then
mm-hmm.
you are the gyani who's going to fill their head.
That's why, ma'am. It is easy to write on that empty slate that you said where nothing has been written, but where already something is written, milk, the bottle is already filled. You
yes.
have to be very conscious about what you are stating, how you are stating, how
yes.
you are convincing. So that's
quite
really
true.
Very important, ma'am.
Quite true. So we, all the courses that we have, we start with what we consider as the experiential. So
Okay.
based on their experience, we offer, you know, the teaching. So we structure our teaching in such a way that first we work with them on what they know. And we start from where they are, what they know, and then we move on to new content.
Yes, ma'am.
So we also follow other adult learning principles, such as that we have to take into account the experience of formal learning that people have had. You see, many adults today, and this doesn't apply only to our country, all over the world, the formal education system treats people quite rough. Quite
Yes,
rough.
Ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So, you know, many times, unfortunately, teachers will be rude to children. They will be sarcastic with them.
Yes, ma'am.
Of course, they lose their temper and they get angry and, you know, unnecessary punishment. And a lot of this behavior with a child results in a fear of learning.
Yes, ma'am.
So when adults come to us, they remember that experience. And they don't immediately start speaking in class because the experience they remember is ki ab ye teacher bolegi chup baitho, baith jao, beech mein mat bolo, because this is what they heard in their childhood, and this is just somewhere subconsciously absorbed because they didn't hear it once or twice.
Yes, ma'am.
School, you know, 10 years of school, another 3-4 years of college life, and this is what you have undergone. So most people, when they come to us, they come with that fear that they will be demeaned or they will be insulted or, you know, then they will be laughed at or scoffed at. With all these fears, they come. So one of the first things we do is we try to make adults comfortable. We try to provide a warm learning climate in which they will feel accepted.
Yes,
and so for us, it is very important that in class, we relate to students with an attitude of warmth and acceptance.
Yes.
And that is the way in which, you know, these students, very quickly they realize.
Yes, ma'am.
This is going to be different. This experience is going to be different. Of course, that doesn't mean that, you know, we are quite particular about attendance and punctuality. And sometimes we also end up, you know, having to tell even adults that, you know, their discipline needs to improve.
Yeah,
but we know the sacrifice that these adults are making in coming to the learning situation.
Yes,
they are coming after a hard day's work.
Yes,
they are traveling all the way to come for these classes. Of course, abhi COVID ki dino mein nahi, but I mean, COVID has not been there always. Okay, so before February 2020, we had these classes, evening classes, Saturday, Sunday, weekend classes, and these adults, they are really motivated to come and learn.
Yes,
and they appear for exams.
I would actually thank you first, ma'am, because you have removed my prejudice as well, where I believed that people from the older generation, like you said, that you were a student in 60s, you have experience of that time. And still look at your evolved nature, like how you have evolved yourself based on the requirement of the time. And you deal with the students based on their requirement. Your students are far matured than the school teachers are dealing with. You have to handle more problems than the school teachers. And still, you are showing your patience. You can empathize with their situation. And that part is actually required in the schools as well. As you said, yes, that is lacking in the schools, which is really required.
Absolutely. You know, from my own experience, I can tell you that I enrolled for my PhD.
Yes, ma'am.
As 1992. So the last exam that I ever sat for was in 1977 when I finished my graduation. In 92, I enrolled for PhD and we had some papers in philosophy of research and statistics and so on. You know, when I sat down to write the statistics exam, my hand shivered. The pen in my fingers shivered. And two little drops of water came in my eyes.
Oh, my God.
Yes. So, I completely, empathy is not difficult to give to an adult learner. You know, from my own experience, I know what it was to sit down for that exam and, you know, appear for it. And I was already in the university. I was already a teacher. And even then, if that was my state, then I can well imagine what people must be feeling when they appear for tests, exams after such a long gap. I
हिंदी में
can
मैम
just
एक बड़ी
imagine.
अच्छी सी कहावत है कि जाके पैर परे न बवाई से का जाने पीढ़ पड़ाई. सो यस
Ah,
ऑफ कोर्स यू
that's a
ऑलरेडी
lovely
हैड
one.
दैट पेन एंड मे बी बिकॉज ऑफ दैट यू वर एबल टू एम्पथाइज इन अ बेटर वे.
Is that from Kabir?
होप सो मैम बिकॉज इट्स लाइक सेइंग.
Yeah, it's a lovely saying. It sounds like it's from Kabir Das.
यस मैम. Ma'am, like in your life throughout this time, you might have inspired so many people with the way you speak and with the way you train them. But I would like to know about any one person, any one thing which you still remember and you feel proud of doing that you were able to transform that person or you were able to make changes in that person, constructive changes in that person. Yes, I know, ma'am. I'm very sorry because there might be so many people in that you might have done,
No,
but at least one with which you have retained and you think that you really feel proud of that.
I don't know, Anupama. I can't really answer that. I don't think, I don't know if that kind of experience I had with my, students. But some of my most touching experiences are with the community health volunteers with whom I worked. So these were women in the slum community, where I worked before I came to TISS. And these were housewives.
Yes, ma'am.
And at that time, the UN had, WHO had introduced, this polio and triple immunization vaccine regimen for children below 5. So we had a clinic running in those slums, and so we began inviting the women's groups to come and understand what immunization was and why they should be given this, why children should be given this. And from that group, about 12, 15 women used to come. We talk to them on children's health, maternal health, nutrition, diet, some basic things like that. And then we had this idea of, barefoot health workers, like that concept. And that can we train these women to, go to houses in the slum? And because they themselves are from that community, they will be able to convince other children better. So out of the 15, 20 women who used to come, five or six women, had that, as we say in Marathi, we say chikati. So they had that perseverance and, to get into this. And then they went from door to door talking about immunization and how it won't hurt you and it's good for the children and all of that. And then we continued. That immunization program was a good success. And then we began more health-oriented classes with these women. When they came to us, these women themselves had children below the age of 10, And as they worked along with us in the NGO, you see the self-confidence that they gathered. And not only self-confidence, they also gathered the confidence to change their own life. So, for example, there was one lady there whose daughter dropped out at ninth standard. And there was a good deal of pressure on her ki ab to ye pad nahi rahi hai, to iski shaadi kar do. And mind you, I'm talking of early 1980s. This experience is early 1980s. So, what, 30 years ago almost?
Yes, ma'am, almost 30.
This lady said, I will send her to learn some craft. Let her learn some bookbinding or bangle making or something. She can sit at home and do this. I'm not getting her married. For a woman from that community, herself, not at all educated or some maybe third or fourth standard or something like that. And for her to just say, to tell her family that I won't get her married. She, you know, she's and What she said in Marathi, she said, ये लड़की मेरे ऊपर कोई भार नहीं है, कोई बोझा नहीं, मैं इसको और संभाल सकती हूँ. ये घर में बैठ के काम करे. दैट्स व्हाट शी सेड.
ग्रेट.
एंड देयर वर इन दैट ग्रुप ऑफ 5 or 6 वुमेन, दिस वाज द काइंड ऑफ सोशल चेंज दैट वी सॉ, यू नो, द चेंज इन देयर थिंकिंग. सो समवेयर व्हेन यू से डिड यू चेंज एनीबॉडीज लाइफ, आई फील दैट यस, इन दैट वर्क मे बी आई वॉज इंस्ट्रूमेंटल, दो आई डिडंट सेट आउट टू डू इट, और यू नो इट वॉज नॉट द गोल that these people should become transformed or they should change or anything. It was all to do with immunization or dose or injection lagao and all that business. But in the process, you know, whatever they did, the way they, there was another lady there who later on became a supervisor for other health workers.
Great.
After about 10 years, yeah, she rose in that job. She had 3 girls, educated all of them as a single parent.
Great.
All of them, they all went into jobs later on, and none of them used to hurry up the marriages of their girl children. And I think that just by giving health classes, by talking to women about immunization, by encouraging them to, you know, just sort of go to different slum communities, and because afterwards they went out of their own community, they went to other communities also to do this work, you know.
Yes,
very
yeah.
small salary, okay, very small salary, but
confidence level and
the way the confidence level improved, the ability to see life from a different perspective, and that marriage was not the end all for a girl, they could stand up for their own children. One of them, you know, when her daughter, maybe her son, wanted to marry somebody from another caste, and she said, it's all right, I will support my boy to marry this girl. So,
yes, ma'am. I mean,
you know, these are the signs of social change, actually. These are signs of, koi badi cheez nahi karna hai, you know, we're not really climbing the Himalayas. But every effort of this sort, where people stand up for themselves, where women stand up for themselves, I mean, this is as good as climbing the Himalayas.
Yes, ma'am, so true. And one more thing, ma'am, I would like to add over here. When you said that you don't remember or you are not aware about your students, but I should tell you, while I inquired about you and when I talked about you with some of your students, they all see a kind of great figure in you. They see a kind of great inspiration in you, and they believe that whatever they are, whatever mindset they have, is just because of you, ma'am.
It is their goodness.
Ma'am, you have seen a lot in your life, and yes, of course, in this life journey where you are talking about 40 years back in the 1980s, where you were able to make some changes in that way, then you have really learned a lot, many things. But any 3 things that you could like count down right now, that these are the best learnings of mine.
So, one thing I learned over a period of time is that if I stick to some idealism, it's good for me.
Yes, ma'am.
So like I told you earlier, I did my graduation in history. And at that time, so 2 years before, you know, when how did I choose history and politics? And I chose Hindi as my subsidiary subject. So it's like I had some thought in my mind,
yes,
that you know, people generally, as they go into higher education, they lose touch with languages. They start taking up very practical subjects like economics, you know, something, you know, which will sort of job oriented,
yes,
and work oriented, and languages, poetry, these are some of the things, literature, you know, jo hum bhool jate hain, wo piche reh jata hai. So I decided that I will take up either history as my major with Hindi as my minor, or I will take up English literature, language, and history as my minor, because history was a love. So history to chhodna nahi tha, but I thought history or Hindi karenge, ya phir English literature or history karenge.
Okay.
If I don't get into history, then I will do literature and history. And when I applied for this combination. My first choice was history and Hindi. When I applied for this, people guided me and said, history is a very scoring subject, history, politics. And if you take Hindi, you can't score in languages.
Okay.
So most people don't get 60, 65. Aapka first class shayad miss ho jayega. Whereas if you... So, you know, my thinking was the other way. Na? I thought literature, language should be encouraged and should be learned. So I stuck by that. And what those people told me was right. I missed my first class in my graduation.
Okay.
So I got a... Yeah, I got whatever was the required percentage in my history politics. But my marks in Hindi pulled me down. And I ultimately got some 60% was a first class. So I got 58 or 58.5, 59. Aise kuch mila. So 12-15 marks se mera first class chhoot gaya. But I don't think I have ever regretted.
Okay.
Because in those 2 years, this language, you know, which I was able to learn more, you know, I was able to learn poetry in this.
Okay.
We learned the whole myth, Rashmi Rathi by Dinkar, you know, by the poet. Yeah. So even today, you know, if you say Mahabharat, then I can only say Karna. I don't say Arjun. I don't say Karna. I only say Karna. Because that, you know, that poem, the power of that poem.
Rashmi Rathi, yes. Yes. Even just reminding that you get goosebumps, like the way Dinkar ji has written, it's really incredible. I have read it so many times. I have recited it so many times. And every time I read it, I really feel, oh my God, yeah. Karna, you were the real hero. Why Arjun is
worshiping? Rongte khade ho jate hai na when you... It is a bada powerful lyric. Then we studied poems by Harivansh Rai Bachchan and, you know, the whole understanding of Chhayavad and what it was. I would have never understood this whole aspect of
Ma'am, I would really like languages. To connect with you after this, like whenever you are free, because I am more into literature, ma'am. I have also written so many poems, published a poem of mine.
Oh, that is wonderful.
Prem Ke Rahasyamayi Rang. And now I am working with Inquest.
I have never written a poem in my life.
But if you are an admirer, of course, maybe because you are not getting time, that's why you are not writing it. I am a teacher and every time I get some time to write. So I will really love to be connected with you just to discuss literature, because literature is my love. I can say my first love.
Sure. So one of the first things I... think I one of my lessons for life is that, you know, if you have some idealism,
stick to your idealism.
You should keep with it, you know.
Yes, ma'am.
Because so only when I relate this story, and every time I relate this story, my thinking gets more and more
evolved,
consolidated, that, you know, wo first class ka koi matlab hi nahi tha.
Ji ji ji.
Usme kuch rakha hi nahi. और कभी वो बीच में आया भी नहीं है, बिकॉज आई मीन यू नो इवन कॉलेजेस एंड ऑल दे आर ओके विद 55%. सो देयर वाज द नेसेसिटी फॉर मी टू बी इन अ कॉम्पिटिटिव रन दैट आई मस्ट गेट मोर देन 60 और व्हाटएवर. उसका कोई मतलब ही नहीं था.
दिस पॉइंट इज रियली वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट मैम. आई रियली विश दैट इट शुड रीच टू द मासेस. At least those students who die for marks, who just want mark, the parent who just need marks, they should at least learn from you. Like how you have come ahead. And of course, at your point, like you may never think that I'm a failure. As you said rightly, that I don't regret of not getting first percentage marks, and it has never come on your way. Whatever
you have done. It has never come in the way. It has never come in the way.
Ma'am, like I have already asked you so many questions, but if you could step into my shoes, what will be the question that you'll be asking yourself that I couldn't ask by now?
Maybe something on resilience.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Maybe something on compassion.
Resilience, compassion. Yes, both the things are really related.
Yeah.
Dedication, resilience and compassion. So 3 points.
Something like that.
So, do you think that resilience and compassion are your key points of your life? Apart from dedication.
I would like to think so. I would hope that I have been able to work towards something like that. Because if one has to grow, if one has to evolve in some sense, I have very strong opinions and views on matters of religion, politics. So all my life I have been guided by the values of people's struggles.
Yes, ma'am.
Secularism and equality.
Yes,
These
ma'am.
are the three things which are really very close to my heart. Because I feel that whatever today is there in the world, whether you say ki 8 hour day, है, या फ्रीडम ऑफ स्पीच है, या फ्रीडम ऑफ असेंबली है, या जो भी है, वॉट एवर द राइट्स दैट यू हैव बीन वन विद ब्लड एंड स्वेट ऑफ पीपल हु स्ट्रगल फॉर. Nobody put it on a plate and gave it to anybody.
Yes, ma'am.
So sometimes I think that in our country, when we tend to, not value some of these constitutional freedoms, then we maybe because the Constitution gave it to us, that people at that time who wrote our Constitution were that much enlightened to say that it doesn't, education doesn't matter. Even if 78% of India is illiterate, we will have electoral system. We will
Yes,
have
ma'am.
votes.
Yes,
We
ma'am.
will have freedom of speech. We will have, freedom to move in the country,
Yes,
freedom to assemble, freedom to ask. All these things, civil liberties which they put down. But there are countries where this was won with great, great blood and sweat.
Yes,
Bahut logon ne. So, those values of struggle, those values of having to fight for something, that these things don't come to you, handed down, like somebody doesn't just give them to you. So those values, for me, they are very important, and I can never lose sight of them.
Yes, ma'am.
Secularism is important to me because I feel that for us, religion should be a matter of personal choice. And in your private life, you can be anything, you can do anything, you can follow any faith. But I think that in public life, we should be secular.
Yes, ma'am.
Because that allows us the freedom to associate with people as people.
Yes, ma'am.
So, humanity should really be the religion. If at all there has to be a religion in public life, it should be.
Yes, ma'am.
And then equality is important for me because in all senses, whatever I have experienced in life in terms of opportunities, I've been very lucky, I should say.
Yes, ma'am.
So for others, I don't want it to be a matter of luck.
Yes, ma'am.
I want it to be a matter of the system, that the system itself has equality. Because अगर अगर वो लक नहीं है, वो चांस नहीं है, तो दैट डजंट मीन यू शुड मिस आउट ऑन.
Yes, ma'am. That's really important. We should not rely on just the luck or the opportunity. We just have to grab whatever we get. And
It
yes, of
should
course,
be
I
there.
too believe in that, ma'am. As I said, I am also a self-made lady. I have also started from scratch, and then whatever I am today is just because I just kept on moving. As you said, just keep on moving, keep up the consistency. And while we are doing so, that compassion and resilience, that is again another aspect which will let you be happy in every situation.
True.
Ma'am, if someone wants to connect with you online just for some sort of counseling or some sort of help, where do you want the people to reach you out?
So I'm not fond of social media at all. I'm not on Facebook or Twitter. So the only place you can find me on is LinkedIn.
Ma'am, at the end now, as the conversation was really so bright and enlightening, you have highlighted so many things with your age-old experience. And now I would request you to tell about any three important things that you really think that everyone in this nation or in this world should remember to stay motivated or to stay consistent in their life?
I think one is to try and find a purpose in
Yes,
life.
ma'am.
And when I say purpose, then I don't mean a goal. Because some people have the purpose in life that in the next 5 years they will have at least a 2-bedroom flat with one car. But that's not purpose.
Okay. So that's again fad you are pointing out. That's not right.
So purpose is really something, that will help you to be at your best. So realizing one's full potential, you have to set something for yourself which will help you to
Okay.
realize your best. And all of us have different potentials. How should we identify those? I think it is good if we talk to people, our well-wishers, people who mean well by us. And I think generally need to keep away from people who are negative with us.
Yes.
This was a very difficult. Sometimes one has been thrown in company with people where nothing good was coming out from it.
Yes, ma'am. So true. Like when you are passionate about something, you are doing something consistently, and still people around you are always there to poke you out. Like just now, you have given the example of Karna. Karna, it is said he was defeated or he was demoralized just because of his sarathi that he had, his driver, who kept on telling that you cannot fight with Arjun. You look, he has the blessings of the God and he's so powerful than you. And just by listening to those words, he really kept on feeling, even though we do know that he was much more powerful, he has so much power, more power than Arjun, and still he was demotivated. And that only killed him by the end. So truly said, ma'am, yes, keep away from the negative people. And yes, everyone should try and find out the purpose, set something for themselves, like what goal is required. That should not be money oriented, or yes, of course, asking for bungalows or some amount of money. That right now, if you have heard about the coaches and all, they ask to visualize what you really want in your life. Find out that dream and then move ahead. So now this is what you are negating and telling. It should be some inner purpose. What
Yes.
changes you want to make? What you really want in your life? And then, yes, of course, identify your whatever potential you have. So thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much for your time and all the kind of experiences you have shared with all of us.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. It's a great honor to talk to you.
And now I would like to thank all my dear listeners who have been listening patiently to all of us. Dear listeners, if you have really loved this conversation and you were able to learn something, then please do share it with your friends as well and those who really need to get such sort of inspiration. Thank you so much. Stay blessed and keep on getting inspired with Comspire. Communicate to inspire.